basically, there's six main points we're going to go through. I am proposing that New York's institutional landscape is changing. There's a shift in the range and complexity of programming at our institutions. And we've seen significant press attention for both these issues. Meanwhile, smaller institutions have been overlooked. So the questions we're proposing today are, what external change has had the greatest impact on your institutions? And then what change would you like to see? So first, a little bit about the shift in range and complexity of programming. I'm going to offer a few examples. The point is not to be comprehensive or exhaustive, just a bit of a roundup, probably some familiar projects that you know. This is the poster for Cultural Economies, Histories from the Alternative Arts Movement, an exhibition mounted by Julie Ault in 1996, which surveyed what became known as the alternative space movement up to that point. A very important show, one of the first of its kind. It purported to evaluate and assess the alternative arts movement, its history, its contributions to the field of contemporary art. It also led to a very important book, Alternative Art New York, 65 to 85, which has a, I guess, a less exacting title. Cultural Economies, I think, is perhaps more relevant for today's discussion. Then this institution probably looks quite familiar. I'm interested in pointing out here the MoMA PS1 merger, which was announced in 99. Calvin Tompkins said, last week's decision by MoMA and PS1 to join forces came as a huge surprise to nearly every art watcher in Manhattan. The deal with MoMA allows PS1 to keep its own staff and structure, but gain access to MoMA's marketing, membership, publishing, and fundraising operations. The primary incentive for MoMA was that the merger would end the persistent criticism that the museum does not do enough for contemporary art. Much is being made of the new cultural corridor, quote-unquote, linking MoMA and PS1. Alana Heiss, the founder, contends that there's nothing about money in this merger. It's about art and dreams, and PS1 is very strong in art and dreams. This is a, unfortunately, kind of dry installation photo from Orchard, a cooperatively run gallery on the Lower East Side from 2005 to 2008. In writing about Orchard, David Joslett said, what is it that most institutional critique has remained satisfied with? The easy targets of bricks and mortar, while setting aside the more volatile flesh, bones, and brains that are just as much a part of an organization's equipment. Orchard did not take the easy way out. Most of its members are associated with quote-unquote institutional critique, but in founding their own organization, a gallery to be run cooperatively for 3 years, they posed a fundamental question. What does it mean to criticize an institution of which you are a member? Joslett, in writing about R.H. Quaitman, one of the founders, a painter you probably know, said, these archival conditions offer a toolkit, one of many Orchard provided over its lifetime, for rethinking the forms and responsibilities of association, for reassembling the social. This is, you know, is the new museum on the Bowery under construction. I like this photo a lot. Carol Vogel, in writing about the new museum's rebirth, said, with growth comes the fear that the museum may become more like others, a place, a larger place, with a bigger building and even more ambition, which can mean losing its edge and settling into middle age. A board member of New Museum at the time said, we can't become a victim of our own success. We're all very conscious, and there's a risk of losing our edge. It's something the board and the staff worry about, so much so that we're all committing to make sure that it won't happen. These two slides, this is a peculiar juxtaposition. You'll see Artist Space's new venue at the top, Artist Space Books and Talks, as it's known. And then on the bottom, the proposed rendering for the new branch of the NYPL on 53rd Street. What do these things have to do with one another? Both, I think, in some ways exemplify an idea that emerged mainly in Europe and was theorized throughout the 90s, known as new institutionalism, which you might shorthand define as the attempt to redefine the contemporary art institution, ready to let go not only of the limited discourse of the work of art as a mere object, but also the whole institutional framework that went with it. And I think that's very clearly demonstrated here, both in the kind of social space that Artist Space is setting up here, and then also this rendering at the bottom, which I don't know if you could tell, but there's about a large, maybe 100-foot staircase for sitting, for conversation, a movie screen. Probably doesn't look much like the libraries we know now. And then, of course, another example of the way programming has evolved at our institutions is Sarah Mitchelson's widely applauded devotion study number one, presented as part of the 2012 Whitney Biennial. The work takes, as its starting point, a 64 performance and enacts a study of Mitchelson's own dance-making history and that of the Whitney's fourth floor. So now the second side of this conversation, the press attention for the changes in the institutional landscape and programming. I'm going to quickly buzz through a few articles that have been written in the last couple months in the Times and elsewhere, just to catch us up. This article, High Culture Goes Hands-On, this is written by Judith Dobrinsky. She says, everywhere we are assaulted by endless opportunities and activities. We text and get texts everywhere we are, even behind the wheel. Trying to keep pace, cultural institutions are changing too, offering more of the kinds of participatory experiences available almost everywhere else. She says Glenn Lowry has seen the future. I think she's being facetious there. In a speech he gave a while back in Australia, he noted he had to make a shift away from passive experiences to interactive and participatory experiences, from art that is hanging on the walls to art that invites people to become part of it. He said that art had to shed the idea of being a repository and become social space. David Byrne, also in on the act of commenting, he wrote a piece called If the 1% Stifles New York's Creative Talent, I'm Out of Here. It appeared in The Guardian and also on Creative Time Reports, the organization's blog. He says, what then is the future of New York, or really of any number of big urban centers in this new gilded age? Does culture have a role to play? Middle-class people can barely afford to live here anymore, so forget about emerging artists, musicians, actors, dancers, writers, journalists. Bit by bit, the resources that keep the city vibrant are being eliminated. One would expect that the 1% would have a vested interest in keeping the civic body healthy, at least. They'd want green parks, museums, and symphony halls for themselves and friends. But it's like funding your own clubhouse. It doesn't exactly do much for the rest of us or for the general health of the city. A short series that the Times ran a couple weeks back, titled Room for Debate, The Cost of Being an Artist. Patty Johnson, the critic, says, asking whether it's too expensive to pursue the arts is a little like asking whether it's too expensive to read or write. Even if we wanted to, we couldn't stop. Making art is not an economic decision for most artists who are continually exploited for their labor and ideas. Meanwhile, the payment of artist fees has never been mandated at a federal, state, or municipal level, which means nonprofits, often starving themselves, frequently do not pay artists. Wage, an artist advocacy group working to secure artist payment from institutions, has created a certification program. When the Whitney Biennial artist Dawn Casper created a makeshift studio space at the museum because she couldn't afford one, she also applied for unemployment insurance. This is Terry Teachout. He wrote a piece called Some Art Institutions Deserve to Fail. This is in the Wall Street Journal in November. He says, what we're seeing here is not a string of isolated high culture horror stories, but something far more significant, something that requires a different kind of response. Might it be possible that some of these institutions should disappear? How many older fine arts organizations are capable of the radical innovation that's necessary to survive in a world of ceaseless competition? Middle-aged arts administrators, after all, cut their teeth during the fat years when performing arts centers and museums were opening all over the country. Alas, they've survived into an ice age of economic contraction, and some of them haven't had an original idea since the 70s. It's in the nature of aging bureaucracies, and nothing is more bureaucratic than a solidly established arts organization, to place self-perpetuation at the top of their to-do lists. Not surprisingly, such bureaucracies tend not to be very good at thinking of new ways to do what they're doing. And Gary Gutting, he wrote a piece for the Times just a few weeks ago, The Real Humanities Crisis is the headline. He says, our economic system works well for those who find meaning in economic competition and the material rewards it brings. But for those with humanistic and artistic life interests, our economic system has almost nothing to offer. Or rather, it has a great deal to offer, but only for a privileged elite. who have the ability and luck to reach the highest levels of humanistic achievement. Fair treatment for writers and artists is an even more difficult matter, which, while ultimately requiring a major change in how we think about support for the arts, fortunately, however, we already have an excellent model, that is our support of athletics, which is curious. Despite our general preference for capitalism, our support for sports is essentially socialist, with local and state governments providing enormous support for teams. So, where does that leave us? We're back to our key questions. I think what we're trying to do is assert some of these institutions into this conversation. And our questions, again, are what external change has had the greatest impact on your institution, and what change would you like to see? And again, I'll just say, I'll underscore that we're thinking about New York almost as a specific site. So I guess we'll start with Ruba.
Thank you, Peter. So to the first question about sort of how New York has shaped how I work at SculptureCenter as the curators, it's really strengthened a feminist position, because a lot of the institutions that Peter mentioned, and you know, many alternative nonprofits, small to mid-scale institutions in New York, have been founded by women, including SculptureCenter, which was founded by Dorothy Denslow in 1928, who was a sculptor. And you know, we have Marcia Tucker at the New Museum, Helene Weiner, Artist Space, who is, you know, these institutions have been founded or led by women. Martha Beck at the Drawing Center, Thelma Golden, Martha Wilson of Franklin Furnace. So, and many of these women actually came from larger institutions to start these organizations that were meant to provide an alternative voice, a space to accommodate diverse positions and support diverse positions and artists and practices. So I think increasingly that's a necessity that is perhaps overlooked in New York City in terms of how attention is directed towards institutions. And I think small-scale institutions are really at play here, but also mid-scale institutions, which I would consider SculptureCenter as a mid-scale institution. We're actually undergoing a capital campaign and expanding our building, you know, a modest expansion, but one that's necessary and has come out of the growth of the institution over, you know, many decades. So, and I think these institutions are essential to support artistic practices and the arc of an artist's career. Often you have an artist maybe starting in a more niche program, and then there's the major museum exhibition. So what happens in between those two moments, I think, is really essential. And a lot of these organizations could and can support artists at points in their career, their development as artists that operate outside of the market. So for an artist to go from a smaller project to a larger institutional show, it's very important for them to have exhibitions in institutions that aren't just commercial galleries. So I think that's an essential issue and concern in the United States and specifically in New York.
Great. Would you say that, I mean, you named a number of institutions that are founded by women. Would you say that SculptureCenter, through its expansion, is trying to elaborate or try to construct a more apparent identity as a almost feminist institution?
I mean, I think people within the institution can be feminist, including myself. But, you know, really it's about scale, opportunities, the kinds of shows you do, the kinds of artists you work with, and while you can, I don't think it's necessarily, you know, our goal isn't to sort of show one type of work or one type of artist, but really to think and be conscientious and sensitive to a range of artists and practices.
Yeah. It's interesting because people often speak of Artist Space as an institution that now has a very clear agenda to promote queer and LGBTQ artists and practices, if you could characterize it that way. And this question of, say, like, what is the role of the staff, the curators, the artistic directors, how that was reflected in the programming, both their personal history, I guess you might even say, and also issues that are, I think they like actively support or consider themselves proponents of. How does that rise to the surface and when?
Well, I think in New York there's a lot of opportunity to sort of push against a lot of market trends or maybe conservative positions. So I think there's a lot of space in New York and opportunities to do programming that operates outside of that. So I think it's you know, the people working within the institution, but I think it's also about, you know, constantly sort of checking and thinking about what's been happening and how do you move forward. And it's not necessarily about numbers, but about, you know, an attitude and sensitivity again. But I think, and I don't mean, you know, a feminist attitude also in terms of sex, it's also a sort of gender attitude. So thinking through that, so I wouldn't, you know, attribute it solely to sex and that you need, you know, people of a certain sex running institutions or working in institutions or even sexual orientation, but really it's more of an attitude or a position.
All right. Plenty to come back to and talk about later. Allison?
Thanks, Peter. Thanks, Claudio. So I'm the founder and director of Recess, a small space in Soho, Manhattan, and we are open to the public, and the works that we're showing are in progress. So we stay open to the public from a day an artist or a collective moves in until the day they move out, and sort of maintaining transparency at every stage of the creative process. And we now run a bunch of other programs in addition to that durational one that sort of founded the organization. And I come from a background in museum work. So I worked at MoMA for several years and then at the Whitney for a good chunk of time. And the reason I left museums to start Recess is I started to notice the ways in which artists and audiences were interacting in cultural institutions as, you know, as a shift taking place toward a more engaged environment. And, you know, I think oftentimes that gets a little bit oversimplified, and we think of that kind of work as participatory work, where, you know, the classic example is a relational aesthetics model where an artist makes a work and a member of the public is required to, you know, the most obvious example would be to drink some soup that an artist has made. And in a gallery setting or in a museum setting. But I think that as more challenging work gets incorporated into these larger institutions, a lot of what's happening with the artist and audience interaction is a bit more nuanced than that. And you can have, you know, a sculptural work in a space, in a creative space, and an audience interact with that sculpture in an engaged manner. When I worked in museums, my favorite part of my job was facilitating an interaction. I worked in the education department in both spaces, so facilitating an interaction between an artist and an audience member that didn't feel like, you know, a staged way of, or a prescribed way of engaging, but something that started a conversation that perhaps didn't have an obvious answer. And so one of the biggest changes that I've seen since running Recess is the way that large-scale institutions are coming back now to smaller-scale institutions in order to diversify their programming a bit or involve some fresh voices, some edgier content into their program. And it's something that I think we've all been talking about together a little bit is how these larger, more established models have come to require the almost like the energy or the risk-taking. You know, we have the ability to produce content that might fail, that is not marketable, as Ruba mentioned, you know. So we have this freedom and this sort of nimbleness that, you know, that is indicative of smaller scale institutions. And I think the larger players have started to come to these smaller institutions to harvest some of this creative energy, which I think, you know, that
can go both ways, right?
Yeah. It absolutely can.
Allison, can I ask you something you said I think speaks to Recess's agency as an institution. So as you mentioned, you're set up in the fabled neighborhood of Soho, which probably leads to a lot of interesting foot traffic. I'm wondering if there's sort of a kind of embedded critique there. Obviously, the neighborhood has a long history of artist studios. Obviously, many of the our forerunners, the older institutions, were founded there. Is Soho a specific site for you, or is there a comment there?
Yeah, it's a very specific site. I also think we're still on SculptureCenter, but that's okay.
Whoops. Where's Recess? Sorry about that.
No worries. Just thought if we're talking about Soho, we can get a visual of how small and scrappy my institution is. but it's a very specific space. You can't ignore the history that's there. And you can't ignore the fact that it would have been so much easier for me to set up the model that we have in Bushwick or in a neighborhood where our rent isn't, you know, 75% of our budget. But to me, one of the interesting parts of being in an established neighborhood in this regard is creating content that not only challenges, you know, the sort of crowd that you're already preaching to. So, you know, we all in this small scale institution world sort of know one another, and we all see each other at the various events and openings and whatnot. And often those happen in outer boroughs. And I was interested in challenging the neighborhood of Soho and also giving our artists the same kind of recognizability and the sort of professional development that comes with having a solo project in a neighborhood like Soho. You know, I think the alternative arts space movement that sort of put the neighborhood on the map has definitely been subsumed by a dominant market. And it's an interesting experiment to put, you know, this institution that's very rough around the edges and allows artists the kind of exposure that they might not have in a less trafficked neighborhood or less established neighborhood.
Cool. Thank you. Miriam?
Hi.
Hey.
Thank you for having me, Peter.
No problem.
I'm the co-founder of a nonprofit press in New York called Primary Information. And I met my co-founder, James Hoff, while I was an intern at Printed Matter, which is another nonprofit institution in New York. And he was the program and grant writer there. And Printed Matter sells artist books, artist writings, catalogs by contemporary artists. And while we were there, James and I both kind of bonded over historical materials that were really inspiring to us, but then also examples of artist books or artist writings that were mostly put out by European publishers. And it was the way that I would discover some artists who became really important to me who I hadn't yet seen in galleries in New York. And we started discussing why there weren't any publishers based in New York who were on the small scale who were devoted to making artist books or artist writings rather than catalogs. Because a catalog is something that a museum or a gallery will happily fund as it celebrates their exhibition and helps to sell an artwork. But an artist book is a project that an artist makes specifically to exist in book form. And that appealed to the both of us because, you know, we feel very privileged to live in New York and encounter some of the best art exhibitions, the best artists, the best archives. But people who live outside of New York, who live in small cities, who are working artists in other countries, should be able to encounter projects in their own time, in multiple different times, years later, in many different cities, and not have to experience it, say, on the internet. So we started talking about making our own press where we could encourage younger artists to make artist books. And part of the reason we were thinking that people had stopped making artist books was because there was so much money that had flooded the market, particularly in New York. And it means that for artists, they can really make a living and gain more than enough exposure through having a single gallery show, a couple of gallery shows. And it didn't really force them to look for other ways of exploring their practice beyond, like, maybe the most marketable shows. So we conceived of this press, and we began with reprinting historical materials. And one of our main aims is to distribute our projects widely, so editions of 1,000 or larger, and to sell them for really cheaply, like $30 or less for the most part. But that is kind of like an impossible task in New York, where the costs are so high and where printing is so high in America in general. So that's why we chose to become a nonprofit as opposed to a for-profit press, so that we could apply for grants and get donations to offset the cost of selling our books.
Miriam, I wanted to ask, so it's been 5 years, 6 years?
Jesus. We officially incorporated ourselves in 2007.
So, and the most major change you've witnessed, or the change that's impacted primary information? And don't say postage rates.
What? Don't say what?
Postage rates. Postage rates.
Postage rates. Oh, my God.
Sorry,
that's huge. I think it's really huge. I think that the change in New York would be just a change in how things are funded. So much funding is privatized at this moment. And so many people in the art world expect their funding to come from galleries rather than organizations or institutions. But another thing that I think has increased the ability for organizations like myself to exist who are interested in books would be the range of printing options. I think you can see that from something like the New York Art Book Fair, where, you know, a publisher can just pop up, publish something on Lulu in a small edition and get an artist exposure really easily. Maybe those are the two main changes.
Interesting. All right. So back to the beginning. I guess Claudia wanted to leave 5-10 minutes or so. Claudia, where are you? How are we doing on time? 10 minutes at least. Okay. So we'll open up to the floor for questions. For any of us here on stage, or if you have your own propositions, changes you have witnessed, changes you would like to see. Yeah.
My name is Catherine. I was thinking a lot about this idea of harvesting.
Can you all do
Can you hear me? You mentioned the term harvest, which made me giggle a little bit, because I do think one of the dangers is that the larger institution, in the very capitalist apparatus way, will try to harvest and sort of consumes the smaller institution within its attempt to utilize that energy and those resources to bring more of an edge to their own space. Can you outline some of the tools that you think are helpful in keeping the autonomy of that space while also taking advantage of what the larger institution can help provide, like financial support?
This question's for Allison?
Yeah, mostly okay. Allison, but I think that for SculptureCenter as well, that's another question that could be answered, is how do you attach yourself to larger institutions and money-making situations while not being absorbed by those things? Okay.
So Catherine sees more and more frequently these sort of partnerships between small and large institutions. And how do you protect yourself? How do you protect your agency?
It's something that we talk about all the time, every day, especially as Recess has been around for about 5 years. I would say as we sort of figured out who we are and what we do best, and some of the larger institutions started paying attention and inviting us to be part of their program. One of the things that's, I think, super important for a small institution is to be really aggressive about the sort of the capital that you have. And I think a lot of the larger institutions come to a smaller institution with the assumption that our marketing platform or the exposure that your small institution will receive from participating in our program should be reward enough for your participation. And I think that it is a wonderful reward, and it can be very useful to help get the word out as to who you are and what you do. But it requires an incredible amount of staff time, and it, you know, oftentimes you're producing projects or events that are outside of the, your everyday operations. And so in order to sort of maintain autonomy, I think the first crucial component is being really confident in what it is that you can offer, and being really clear about how you can engage in these collaborations, so that they're truly collaborative and so that they're helping to sustain your organization rather than being an additional drain on your resources. And when we first started engaging in these partnerships, I don't think I got that. And it's only after, you know, doing them for several years that I realized that that an organization like the New Museum really does need Recess, and that I can be confident in saying, the reason you're coming to us and asking for our participation is because you perceive a gap in your own programming, and almost like a consultancy model.
Yeah, this is a subject I'll just say quickly that, speaking with my Triple Canopy hat on for a second, we've become very interested in as well. We've partnered with many institutions, MoMA, PS1, most recently, soon the Whitney. I think there's this sort of residual idea, because most museums are used to doing their own artists, that they can, basically say, here's your space, put on your show, and your budget is a big fat zero. By accepting these invitations, I think, and actually trying to make at least an argument for a larger budget, actually sort of holding your ground, so to speak. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But I think increasingly there's a difference in the way larger institutions regard the small ones that are entering in. And I hope that this will also trickle down to the artists who are being invited to do projects as well. Right now, I definitely feel there's an imbalance there, and that's something I feel a little conscious of. But.
Hi.
Hey, Mary.
Lots of times funders, like individuals and funding organizations, want to see five-year plans, and they want to see that a small organization has the intention to grow for them to be able to fund you, or the chances would increase if they would fund you if that was the case. But if your intention is not to just become bigger, 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 what is your five plan, well, all of you, like, what does your five-year plan look like, and what are your long-term goals as a staying as a small institution?
Miriam, do you want to answer first? Because you just made a big change yourself.
Yeah, five-year plan. Thanks, Mom. Sorry. For us,
what are you doing with your life?
Yeah. Damn if I know. For us, I think we would like to stay as a very lean organization while at the same time build up our infrastructure. So we recently started paying ourselves something that is like really kind of nominal, but just to show that we want to get to a point where we can have employees that help us rather than freelancers or paid interns that come in and out. And we try to grow our budget for projects rather than our budget for, like, you know, bringing on many staff members, or, like, for example, we tend not to do events because that brings us to one specific place and one specific time. So, you know, we just try to every year perhaps double our budget for books, while at the same time showing that we are, like, you know, getting better at accounting, getting better with our board of directors, like really basic things that show funders that they can have confidence in you, you know?
I think it's, I think this idea of, I mean, this comes up in mid-scale institutions, which I think is a really interesting sort of situation where you have more expenses, you have more overhead, but, you know, it's not as high as a major institution, and you don't, like a, you know, huge mega institution like, I mean, MoMA, for example, or, you know, where, like, I think when you're in that level, it's very important to get funding and get support. I mean, SculptureCenter, most of our funding, the largest percentage is actually from individuals. And, you know, I think it's important that these kinds of institutions are supported, because whereas in a small institution, you know, a small donation may go a longer way, a mid-scale institution has to grapple with those expenses, a different kind of programming, more support for artist projects. And so it's just operating at a totally different level, which I think kind of gets left out of that conversation of the huge and the small. You know, sort of where does that go, and how do you, you know, when you don't have the necessarily the visibility of an institution that could get maybe major corporate funding or, you know, go down those avenues, what do you do when you get to that point? And I think you see, you know, institutions sort of stay small or get bigger and bigger and bigger. And it's I think it's really hard to find that
balance. Ruba, you mentioned to me recently that SculptureCenter, part of its mandate has become showing more international artists and in almost like a smaller, more contained space. Would you say that's part of the five-year plan? Is this sort of shift in the artistic direction, if you want to call it that?
I mean, we've always shown international artists. We have a really international program. But we're actually showing more multiple solo shows, which is happening at the moment. So we have two solo shows on at the same time. March 1st, we open 4 solo exhibitions. So this is a way for us to give artists opportunities at different points in their career. So it's not, it's just operating on a different level. And really, the point is to accommodate artistic practice at different stages in an artist's career so that they're not, you know, we show many international artists in our solo exhibition program and our group shows, but sort of where is that middle ground where you can have a more mid-sized project by an artist at a different point?
Allison, 5 years down the line, where are you?
You know, I think a lot of small-scale institutions are, or at least in the beginning, can fall into the trap of thinking, you know, I became a small-scale institution because I wanted the flexibility that offers, and I wanted to, I wanted the nimble aspect of saying yes to great opportunities, and, you know, and I would say that's one of the reasons I left museums to do this work. But there is a difference between bureaucracy and structure. And I think that it's possible to have a really strongly built organization that continues to hone its various components without growing exponentially and becoming, you know, just sort of blending into the bureaucratic landscape of these, you know, these more homogenous organizations. And so, you know, when people ask what's Recess going to be in 5 years, my answer is that it'll look the same. The programming hopefully will continue to get better and better. I trust it will. But from the outside, we're not looking to acquire 10 more spaces. We're not looking to, you know, have posters all over Soho, you know, to reference one particular organization. But we'll look the same. And for example, you know, when I reference the percentage of our rent, when we started in Soho, our rent really was close to 50% of our budget, and now it's much closer to, you know, I would say roughly around 18% of our budget, which is still very high, but it represents a shift, as Miriam was discussing, toward artists and really prioritizing growth in program and in not just the programs, but having the money we spend on programs go directly to the artists we're serving. And so growing fees that we give to our artists, growing honoraria that we give to our artists, starting to pay very close attention to these sort of, you know, structure that an organization like Wage is putting forth, and making sure that we're doing a good job of that.
Any other major changes people are seeing out there in New York? Changes they'd like to see? We're looking for proposals, guys. Anyone else? Okay. Claudia, how are you doing on time? 5 minutes. One more question. Yep. Mike is coming around.
Hello, guys. Ruba said something really interesting, which was that all of these institutions have been founded by women in New York, and I was just wondering if you could speak to, I never thought about that before as a condition. I kind of noticed, like, you know, obviously the New Museum is founded by women, and the Studio Museum, et cetera, et cetera. But I was wondering if you could kind of connect the dots a little bit on that and kind of develop, like, why you think that might be, because I never really thought about that before, but it's a really interesting condition that I find very exciting.
So do any of you have a thesis as to why some of the institutions are founded by women?
I mean, it would be hard to kind of get into it totally here and in this context, but, you know, like I said earlier, I think it's really about divergent voices and supporting those. And I think it is an interesting fact that many of those women came from larger institutions that perhaps couldn't accommodate that kind of program. And I think, you know, of course the climate has shifted, but I think it's important to consider what that means today and look at the legacy of those organizations and those actions and consider them as we are all, you know, cultural agents in some way. How do we, you know, engage our programming from that perspective? But I think it's a very important reality that developed, that, you know, brought that, that sort of constituted that growth of institution and those endeavors. But, you know, I think there's something to think about.
Is it responsive? Would you guys say that the commercial sector is predominantly male? Or I guess you could even say, you could look at the large museums in New York. Has MoMA ever had a female director in its history? I don't think so. Is
there
a reaction?
So many great galleries in New York, at least, are founded by women. And if not founded by women, then you have major directors that are women. So I don't feel like in the commercial world there is that kind of divide. But at the same time, I think if you look at ultimately who are the most powerful people in the art world, they tend to be men. And maybe it is like setting up these alternative spaces or, you know, alternative perspectives that is kind of like left to some amazing renegade women.
There are also a ton of women working in the arts.
I just want to say that it's also not about sex too. I mean, I think that's something that's really important to clarify. It's a gender position, and that's, I think, something that, you know, you can think of in relation to the market and to different arts institutions. I think you can consider them that way. And if you do want to look at sex, then there are plenty of numbers about solo shows with women, and you just look at it through the artists. You know, and I think that's you know, something that is interesting to consider right now. And you know, people have brought this up several times, but I think we're in a situation where people talk about money a lot and power, and, you know, it's just something to think about.
They're listening. Okay. Any final questions? Anyone? All right. Ruba, thank you. Allison, thank you. Miriam, thank you. And thanks, Claudio, and thanks to the fair for hosting us.